Up first this week is the passing of a longtime Los Alamos representative, Jeanette Wallace. The 77-year-old was in her 11th term in office and sat on the powerful House Appropriations and Finance Committee. Dan, also the state's only rep from Los Alamos, your memories of her, of course you served with her. What are your best memories of Ms. Chavez?
Well, she worked really hard for her constituents. Yeah. I mean, everything was about Los Alamos, her district. Nobody told her what to do.
Really?
If you went to her, and when I was whip and you would try to go to her and tell her, we need you to do this, she let you know that you don't tell her what to do about anything.
Sure.
She was tough. Worked very hard. Definitely someone who felt that she was doing the right thing all the time. Her and I did not agree many of the times, ideologically, vote-wise, but you could never question her desire to do right for her district and her desire to make New Mexico better. She was a true New Mexican that loved this state.
And in a small community like Los Alamos, that's a loss, mm-hmm. because after
Absolutely.
11 terms, you know everyone. Yeah. You know?
Absolutely, yeah. No, yeah, she really set the bar for public service. I mean, yeah. she did, and my thoughts go out to her family, and Absolutely. I didn't know her personally, but I know that she was very well regarded on both sides of the aisle.
Sure. Mm-hmm. Constituents loved her. What can you say? I mean,
the articles,
you know,
I've been reading say that, you know, you're right, that you didn't know whether she was a Republican or Democrat. She made up her own mind. There's somebody there that was able to cross the aisle, I'm sure, on a regular basis.
Sure. 2,400 calls in just 4 days. That's so many complaints poured into the child abuse hotline. In the days after the Pound Save, quote-unquote, number was announced, that's at CYFD, but some are worried the hotline is already turning into a complaint line for people looking for revenge against a neighbor, an ex-spouse. Sophie, you deal with this a lot in your work with social media, that is, it's one thing to have a conduit system for information. Mm-hmm. It's a whole other thing to manage it once you get it landed, so to speak.
Absolutely, and to sort through, I think it's a tremendous, as in very large job, that CYFD has to mm-hmm. manage this new line. And one of the real challenges is that when you make something as accessible as they've made this line, you really do open it up to abuse. So CYFD, yes, needs to be focused on publicizing that number, but also focused on publicizing the appropriate use for that number.
We were joking earlier, Phil, about the crazy 911 calls that we've all heard online and other places. You know, once you get human beings in the mix, not everyone is rational, right? So it has to be dealt with.
And I think the concern is so many calls,
yeah.
and then no one's realizing from the backside the investigation that goes on these calls.
Right.
You can't just say, oh, I got a call, I don't believe it's real.
Right.
So now we got to investigate it. I think the number is 150 investigators for the state. That's just never going to cover the amount of calls that they're getting. Yes, there's going to be abuse. Yes, someone's going to call up and say something stupid, and they're going to check it out, and it's going to hit the news, and we're going to get to hear the sound bite and lose our brains.
Going to hold you guys there. Sorry about that. Now, officials in Rio Rancho and Albuquerque are considering a drastic approach to make sure there's enough water to go around in the coming years. They're exploring the idea of an underground storage by either filling wells with outside water or spraying water on the surface so that it soaks into the underground aquifer. Phil, let me stay with you on this. Not a cheap option, but, you know, we're in a drought. It's a bad one, and so perhaps all ideas should be on the table. Do you agree with that?
Oh, absolutely. You take the San Juan River, the Animas River, the La Plata River up in the Four Corners, all going to different places to try to feed it. Gallup wants that water up
sure.
in the Four Corners. In the situation here, they want to get away from looking at that groundwater all the time.
Right.
We've got to get more of that surface water, and so we got to do something with that.
Sure. Steffi, what do you think? Good
no,
idea?
I agree. I think we need to explore all options. I mean, water's a huge issue in the state, but we mm-hmm. have to make sure that it's cost-effective, too.
Meaning if it costs more than we're going to get a return on.
Right.
Well, it depends on, I mean, what's the cost?
Sure.
You know, I mean, what is the ultimate cost? If you're going to bring more people, they're going to live, they're going to move, they're going to get jobs, they're going to pay tax revenue, mm-hmm. how do you extrapolate that and say what the cost is? I can't believe that we're actually thinking about spraying water on the ground and hoping it makes it to the aquifer
in New Mexico
where it's as dry as it can be. There's many projects out there. There's a project right now that's been in the paper recently that they're talking about building a pipeline from Fort Sumner, bringing water up to here. There are places in the state that have water.
Sure.
There are places, you go down in Roswell in that area where we've spent millions, hundreds of millions of dollars of taxpayer money to shore up water rights, retire water rights. There's plenty of water down there, and we're going to have to find a way to move that to the right places.
Sure. Roswell is once again the center of the UFO conspiracy universe. The FBI released a 1950 memo this week that seems to confirm that an Air Force official recovered three so-called flying saucers in New Mexico just 3 years after the alleged Roswell crash. Stephanie, does this put an end to the debate, Well, should the city fathers in Roswell be happy about this?
Have you met him? I didn't even know this was up for debate. I thought we've already have our evidence. No, I'm joking. Yeah, it'll be interesting to see. I haven't had an opportunity to read the memos in full, but yeah.
Sure. Got to go back to you, Dan, on this. This is a good thing for the city of Roswell.
You know, it's a great thing. And I used to tease Senator Jennings. You know, I tell everybody that 9 months to the day after they crashed, he was born. And so, it's proof that they were there. So it's great for Roswell. If you've never been there for the Roswell UFO Festival, it's a phenomenal time.
It's fantastic.
Really great.
Okay.
And what's amazing is the amount of people who really care about this from other countries. There's tours from Japan, Hong Kong. They come all the way over here for that 4th of July weekend, and you can't even get around Roswell. It's a great economic development. It's great tourism. And it's actually something that's really questionable. I mean, did it or did it not happen? And I think there's a lot of evidence that points to it happening. But I think if you really want to find out the truth, you got to go spend the weekend in Roswell.
I'm going to let that be the last word. That was so beautiful. True believer. Be sure to let us know what you think about any of the topics we covered on this week's show, including Dan's take on UFOs. You can send us an email at infocus@canamia.org, or you can also give us a call at 277-1246. That's all the time we have for this week. Be sure to join us again next time when we sit down with U.S. Congressman and Senate hopeful Democrat Martin Heinrich. We will also talk to the original Julian Assange. Long before WikiLeaks, there was Daniel Ellsberg and his bold decision to leak the Pentagon Papers during the Vietnam War. My exclusive interview with the person dubbed the most dangerous man in America next Friday night at 7 here on KNME. Until next time, thanks for watching, and remember to stay enchanted, New Mexico.